Lockdown America is a book that tries to explain why the United States, with 4% of the world's population, has 25% of its prisoners. And I think to do that, you have to go back to the late 1960s, when this whole buildup that we're still in, this criminal justice buildup, begins. And it begins in response to two parallel and separate but related crises. The first is the political crisis of rebellion that you're all familiar with, the civil rights movement, the black power movement, the anti-war movement, the poor people's movement, a rather undiscussed rise in rank-and-file labor militancy. All this is animating the political scene in the late 60s. And more than any of that, rioting, right? Massive, from 65 on, massive urban riots every summer. The other crisis is final breakdown of the wave of accumulation from the post-World War II era, the breakdown of that golden era in capitalism. And these two things emerge at the same time, and they're both absolutely essential for understanding the situation we're in now, but they need to be separated and dealt with in that way. So first, the political crisis. The late 1960s, as I said, are chaotic. By 1967, Lyndon Johnson and other elements in the ruling elite in this society realize that part of the problem is that the police are not up to the task of repressing and containing rebellion. The cops, in fact, are making things worse. And at the time, they talked about a crisis of policing. The cops are making things worse in a technical sense, either applying too much or too little repression. How did they make things worse? By applying too little repression. Well, Watts would be an example. In 1965, you have Daryl Gates, a young officer, trying to coordinate what he called the putting down the rebellion. And he has to coordinate three different law enforcement agencies, the LAPD, the Highway Patrol, the Sheriff's Department, but they haven't trained together. They don't have compatible communications. There's confusion, paralysis, then total breakdown, then withdrawal, and that's what allows the Watts riots to jump off. And this is problematic because the U.S. at that time, you have to recall, is fighting a battle against Soviet socialism, but also against social democracy, creeping social democracy around the world. And it's trying to make the case in every forum possible internationally that capitalism and the American system are the way to go. So when Watts explodes, it puts the lie to the idea of racial progress and democracy in the U.S., and it undermined the legitimacy of the U.S. An example of how the police made things worse by applying too much repression would be the Chicago Democratic Convention of 1968, where they wade into the crowd, crackheads, beat people senseless, but to what effect? It doesn't scare the movement, it doesn't send people home. It emboldens people even further in the movement. It divides the Democratic Convention, splits it down the middle. You have mainstream Democrats demanding that the whole convention be called off and move somewhere else because the Chicago police are so out of control. And again, that's another spectacle internationally that humiliates and delegitimizes the whole U.S. project. So Lyndon Johnson devises legislation in 67 that passes through the House in 1968 in April, just as DC coincidentally happens to be on fire and black people are smashing stores that have been ripping them off for years and taking stuff. And Congress, as smoke billows up from the ghettos of DC, passes this law that Johnson has written, and that law, the Omnibus Crime and Safe Streets Act of 1968, creates the LEAA, the Law Enforcement Assistance Administration, this huge federal bureaucracy, which for the next 10 years redistributes about $1 billion a year to local law enforcement. And the idea is to get the cops up to speed, to get them the communications equipment they need, to teach them to read. Before that, cops didn't know how to, they didn't have to know how to read. Beauticians in almost every state needed more training than cops, to get them helicopters, computers. In other words, to provide them shoulder radios, to give them the infrastructure that we associate with modern policing. And that's when the present moment in policing begins. That kind of plateaus in the late 70s because after most big departments have gotten SWAT teams, helicopters, all that stuff, in part because of Watergate, which delegitimizes to some extent police powers, the government generally. The church committee hearings does the same thing. So it's, things sort of plateau. Activists are demanding that the LEAA deal with the spectacle and horrors of Southern penitentiaries, which remained totally unchanged for the entire century up until that point, and you had into the late 70s, you had penitentiaries that were controlled by prisoners. Arkansas, for example, had 3,000 prisoners and 27 civilian employees. And their guards were trusty shooters. They were prisoners who were given shotguns and high-powered rifles and offered pardons if they shot escapees. And that's how these prisons ran. It was an absolute human rights disaster and, again, you know, undermined the legitimacy of the U.S. So the LEA kind of gets turned towards dealing with that. So that's the first part of the current buildup. The second part begins in the early 80s, and that requires going back to the political economic crisis of the late 60s. What was that crisis? Basically, the U.S. emerges from World War II as the world's leading economic power. Along with millions of people having been killed, billions of dollars worth of stuff have been destroyed. Japan and Europe are in devastation, and the U.S. emerges as the industrial power internationally, in the capitalist camp at least. In fact, the U.S. is supposedly producing 40% of the world's output in 1945. So the next 20, 25 years are a process of rebuilding those other two poles of world capitalism, and in part to stave off the threat of sort of nationalist economic projects and socialism. The third world is also industrializing. And the U.S. or U.S. corporations are in a position to reap the lion's share of the benefit of that whole process of reconstruction. And that's when you get the golden age of American capitalism. Business finds itself with such high profit rates that they can afford higher taxes, they can afford to pay higher wages, and still have record profits. In fact, after-tax profits in the U.S. peak in 1961 at about 10%. And they had, in fact, never been higher than that, even in the good old days before the New Deal and all of that. That begins to break down in the mid-late 60s because Japan has recovered, reindustrialized, Europe has recovered and reindustrialized. Those economic regions are supplying their own markets, right? Those had been markets for U.S. Consumer goods, places to lend capital, places to sell machinery. Now those economies are doing that for themselves and increasingly importing to the U.S. And ultimately what happens by the late 60s, early 70s is that there's a global crisis of overproduction, or what Marxists call overaccumulation. And it's a classic problem that capitalism faces. The problem is this: when things work out for the system, right, when there aren't problems, there's finally too much stuff and not enough demand. And then there's inevitably a crisis. So that happens late 60s. By the early 70s, profit rates have collapsed in the U.S. to around 3.4%. And capital is looking for a way to boost profit rates. Well, the natural thing to do, of course, would be to turn on labor, right? To take back those gains that labor had made throughout the New Deal and throughout the era of, you know, the golden era of capitalism, during which there was plenty of conflict between capital and labor. But the problem is they tried to do that, but they found that labor was too strong. Labor was not responding to the usual mechanisms, the main mechanism being rising unemployment. So in the late 60s, early 70s, unemployment begins to go up, yet wages continue to go up. And this is an unprecedented, historically unprecedented situation. This is the Phillips curve being out of whack. Why was that? Well, nothing illustrates one of the reasons better than this story. In 1968, 12 unions struck GE, which at the time was the fourth largest employer in the U.S. and the most anti-labor of the big blue chip manufacturing corporations. And the unions won. They beat GE and they got their demands. And the board of directors of GE did an analysis after the strike, and they found that, among other things, the strikers were collecting not only their strike pay, but welfare from the government. They had, in fact, collected $25 million in welfare. So from the point of view of the board of directors of General Electric, they're being taxed by the federal government so that the federal government can subsidize class warfare against them. And that, for them, was the meaning of welfare. Yeah, definitely the way it ought to be, indeed. So that meant that, I mean, welfare, this in, you know, creeping social democracy in the U.S. as a result of the New Deal, as a result of the war on poverty, had to go. And beginning in the early 70s, a new right-wing consensus is developing. But it takes a whole decade for that new consensus to really gain control. And the first sort of event in that coup is the appointment by Carter of Paul Volcker as chairman of the Federal Reserve. He's a monetarist, non-Keynesianist, hardcore right-wing guy, wants to increase unemployment. That's followed up by Reagan's election. Volcker plunges the economy into the worst recession since the Great Depression. He does this by jacking interest rates from 7% and change in 79 up to 16% and change in 1980-81, beginning of 81. That just like puts the brakes on the U.S. economy and actually the world economy. And as a side note, you know, you have to remember that the entire world at this point, due to the OPEC boom and all the petrodollars, is heavily in debt. So this recession becomes a way of leveraging the entire planet. But that's another story. So that recession, the worst recession since the Great Depression, is followed up by Reagan on the policy front by stacking the National Labor Relations Board with absolute conservatives who always rule against labor, doing the same thing to the federal courts, gutting HUD, slashing AFDC, doing an all-out assault on labor and all of the supports that support poor people and the unemployed, but also indirectly support labor. So that project is done so as to restore profit rates, and it basically begins to work. He also, you know, allows changes to the law, so deindustrialization, capital flight, increased speculation, all that sort of stuff is easier to do to boost capital's share of the economic pie. Does it work? Definitely. No example better illustrates that than this fact. In 1980, not a single union contract involved a wage freeze or a wage giveback. In 1982, 44% of all new union contracts involved wage freezes or outright wage givebacks. So as the 80s roll on, profit rates recover, but there's a new problem that emerges. This huge increase in poverty, deindustrialization, hyper-ghettoization, the class, and in this country due to white supremacy and the way that class oppression and racial oppression are always concomitant, class and racial cleavages in the society increase massively. And that's problematic for capitalism. It's problematic because it delegitimizes the system. It's problematic because it offends the sensibilities of the moneyed classes. They don't like to be around poor people. They don't particularly like to be around poor people of color. And it threatens capital because the poor have always rebelled historically, and they could threaten to rebel again. So how do you manage this contradiction? Well, parallel to that, and not necessarily directly in response to that, you get the Reagan war on drugs ramping up, first slowly in 1982, then in earnest in 84, and you get the return of these big federal crime bills, such as the one in 68. 84 is the really first big one. Then 86, huge, massive crime bill. That's when you get 82, you get the creation of assets forfeiture squads, where local law enforcement are allowed to keep, in some cases, up to 90% of the wealth they confiscate if it's drug tainted. That's to encourage them to get into the war on drugs. 84, you get the mandatory minimum sentencing. 86, you have massive federal grants for policing. Then you have another crime bill in 88. You have Clinton come in. He promises straight up to put 100,000 new cops on the street, and he delivers that in 1994 with a $30+ billion crime bill that has in many ways completely transformed the nature of policing. 96, the effective death penalty and anti-terrorism act. The 96, the basically anti-immigrant act called EREA, which provides massive amounts of money for further militarizing the border and for creating what's called interior enforcement, which is really this, you know, apartheid system of policing. So you now have the Border Patrol, I'm sure many of you know this, conducting huge paramilitary operations, interagency cooperations with local police, state attorney generals, investigators, DEA agents on meatpacking communities in the Midwest. And it's apartheid policing. They're after Latino working class people and no one else. So that's the second part of the buildup. The second part of the buildup is about managing the inevitable poverty that comes with restructuring capitalism so as to improve profit rates. The first part of the buildup, just to recap, was in many ways counterinsurgency by other means. It was about containing rebellious communities, getting the cops up to speed so they could fight a political war against rebellious people, and also so they could just maintain order. So that, I think, is where we are at the moment. And what do we need? Well, I mean, I think what we need is less. I mean, the first thing to demand is less. You know, we need less surveillance, less cops, less concern with crime and deviance and all that sort of stuff, and to try and reframe the debate.